first Sunday in the Lenten season. We gather in the Lord's name today, and we begin this Lenten season that, I don't know about you, but it seems like Lent's been going on about 11 months now, right? But welcome this morning on this beautiful morning, and let's begin our worship as always in song. I do want to go ahead and say thanks to the Lord for successful surgery for the baby Isaac Nettles. The surgery went very well, and swapped a lot of messages with Brad, but they're good, and I'm so thankful to God that it's now passed them. You know, as parents, I can only imagine that surgery that they had this week and how they've been anticipating this for so many months, and now to have that chapter passed and begin, continue the healing process and preparations for coming home. So anyway, just so thankful this morning as we gather together. So let's stand and lift our voices in song to the Lord. Our God is mighty to save.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Let us pray. Almighty God, whose blessed Son was led by the Spirit to be tempted by Satan, come quickly to help us who are assaulted by many temptations. And as you know the weaknesses of each of us, let each one find you mighty to save through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Reading from the book of Genesis. Then God said to Noah and to his sons with him, "Behold, I establish my covenant with you and your offspring after you, and with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the livestock, and every beast of the earth with you, as many as came out of the ark. It is for every beast of the earth I establish my covenant with you, that never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of the flood, and never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth." And God said, "This is the sign of the covenant that I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you. For all future generations, I have set my bow in a cloud, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring clouds over the earth, and the bow is seen in the clouds, I will remember my covenant that is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh. And the water shall never again become a flood to destroy all flesh. When the bow is in the clouds, I will see it, and I will remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is on earth." God said to Noah, "This is the sign of the covenant that I have established between me and all flesh that is on the earth." The word of the Lord.
After Jesus was baptized in the Jordan River, God led him to the desert. Jesus was all alone without any food for 40 days. He prayed to God for help, but it was still really hard to be in the wilderness. Jesus got very hungry. His stomach was rumbling. The devil came to Jesus and tried to tempt him. "If you are God's son, tell the stone to turn to bread for you to eat." Jesus remembered God's words and answered, "No one can live on food alone." Then the devil led Jesus up to a place where he could see all the kingdoms of the world. said, I can give the world to anyone if you turn away from God. You could be king with power over all of these lands. People would worship and honor only you. Jesus remembered more of God's words. Worship and serve only God. Lastly, the devil tempted Jesus to jump off the roof of the temple. If you are God's son, jump. God will send angels to protect you. They will catch you so you will not get hurt. Jesus knew the word of God also says, don't test God. Jesus was tempted 3 times to go against God's word. Each time Jesus knew God was with him, each time Jesus said no. Jesus was in the desert and hungry for a long time, and he was happy that God was always with him, especially when he was tempted to do wrong. The word of the Lord.
Season has started, and I want to ask you all this morning, Our children, anyone, what you notice is different today? What's different than last Sunday?
No flowers.
No flowers in the Lent season. So the two pedestals up in the front don't have any flowers on them. What's something else? That's right. That's one. Different cross. Okay, we have a wooden cross with a crown of thorns on it. And so the brass cross is across the way in the parish hall for Easter. And a different cross, all right? So a different cross, no flowers. What else do you notice? How about the candles? Only one candle on each side today, right? That's different. Anything else you notice?
The linens.
What's that? You got to talk about it for me.
The linens.
The linen. All right. What's up with that? The frontal is linen now. And it's not white like it was. And then the stoles that we wear are linen for Lent. It's a simpler fabric, and it's a fabric that reminds us of sackcloth. And in old times, a time of penance and fasting, linen with these colors on it, representing Jesus' blood, the red, and then black, to remind us of ashes, to remind us that we are but dust, and also black, which is to remind us of our mortality and of death, and Jesus' death on the cross. And then also you see on here, what else is this design? It's thorns, like what was placed on Jesus' head, okay? So definitely some things that are different in the way that the church looks this morning as we mark the different season that we're in. And that's one of the aspects of our church and our Anglican tradition, is that we mark seasons in the church year in the rhythm of the year and the rhythm of life. We mark time, we mark changes, we mark seasons in the church year, just like you mark seasons in your own life. Now, for those of you who are a little bit older like me, I was thinking this week about different seasons and different marks in life that I remember, and one of them for me certainly is Hurricane Hugo, way back in 1989. Now, I can't tell you what I did on Tuesday, but I can tell you what I was doing the week of Hugo, because you know what I'm talking about? It's such a prominent time, or 9/11. I bet you remember a lot of details about 9/11. What'd you do on Wednesday? I don't know. Because it was an ordinary day. But you remember the marked times in life. Just like I know that Brad and Amanda will mark this time, they will mark this week in their lives forever. This is a defining week for them. Now think about in your life and in your family, a marked time. Maybe it's getting a puppy, like you all got this week, right? That's a marked time. You remember getting a puppy and what that was like. I feel like as we mark the beginning of this Lenten season, I don't know about you, but I feel like we've been in Lent for about 11 and a half months now. Since this pandemic started, right? It kind of feels like that. And I can mark when this, at least for me, when this started, it was on a Thursday, and I was getting ready to watch a game in the ACC tournament on the television. Clemson was supposed to play Florida State, and they came out, and the game was canceled. I was like, what? And then, less than 2 hours later, I got a phone call, and the convention of our diocese, which was supposed to be on Saturday down in Bluffton, was canceled. And I thought to myself, this just got pretty real. And it's been going on ever since, right? And it's felt like this pause, this Lent, that's lasted for over 11 months now. And March the 12th, I went back and looked up exactly what day it was, because it was on a Thursday, I know, but the date was the 12th of March. It'll be 1 year into this pandemic. So what does that have to do with today? Well, actually it does, If you look at your gospel lesson today, the story of Mark's gospel, Mark time, has three movements in it in this gospel lesson. John the Baptist comes onto the scene in the first scene, if you will. Mark's gospel was written to be performed. Most people back then didn't know how to read. And so this was written as a narrative, and it was written to be acted out and narrated. And so you've got John the Baptist, this weird dude who pops out onto the scene dressed in sackcloth and linen with a leather belt. And he's, remember what he's eating? Remember that? The locusts and the wild honey. And he's proclaiming in the wilderness this repentance. And then you've got a scene change, and you've got Jesus coming out and being baptized. And the Holy Spirit descends on him like a dove. And then you've got another Mark time. Because after that scene, Jesus goes out into the wilderness, and he is there for 40 days, being tempted by Satan. It is a Mark time in the 30-year-old life of Jesus of Nazareth, God incarnate, Jesus of Nazareth. It is a defining moment in his life and in his ministry, when his ministry is about to begin. Okay? He has grown up. He's reached the age of 30, which is the youngest age that a rabbi can be. He's ready to begin his ministry. John the Baptist is out preaching repentance, and that one mightier than he is coming. And then this defining moment, and Jesus comes to be baptized. And then he goes into wilderness time. I have felt like, as I said, 11 months of wilderness time. And usually on this first Sunday in the Lenten season, I talk about temptation. And y'all may remember sometimes I've had a wet paint sign out to see if anybody will touch it. Because when we see a sign that says, wet paint, don't touch, first thing you want to do is touch it, right? But this year, when I read this gospel lesson, the word wilderness just jumped out at me. Because I have felt for so long like this wilderness time, like somebody hit the pause button 11 months ago. And I'm ready to hit play and get on with it. But this time, this marked time that I'll always remember, this 1 year of pandemic pause, it's a good analogy for this 40 days that our Lord was in the wilderness, the 40 years that Israel wandered in the wilderness after they left Egypt and before they went into the promised land. Mark times in your life. Think about it. Think about when those might be. I even thought about this morning as I was coming up 61, and I was thinking about Mark times, and I thought about the first time that I came to this place in 2006. And I knew that a new chapter was about to begin in my life. This pause time that we've all been in, this wilderness time, I want to suggest to you that in these pause times, in these wilderness times, our Lord gives us an example of two things that I want you to think about. I want you to think back and to think forward about how this pause time has been for you. Because our Lord, out in the wilderness, the first thing that he does is he prevents, in this pause, he prevents Satan from taking control of his life. In these pause times, in these wilderness times in our life, these times that we feel alone or isolated or stuck at home or not able to do things like we normally do, church events, school events, sporting activities, you name it, they've been paused. And the devil can work in our lives. And Jesus gives a model of preventing the devil from getting a foothold. He quotes scripture back to the devil. He's in prayer. He relies on the Lord. And we should do the same. How have you been at preventing the devil from working in your life? And then secondly, how is the Lord preparing you for the next chapter? I hope and I pray that in the coming months we start coming out of this wilderness time. That this comes to a close, that we are prepared for the next chapter. And I feel like there's a great analogy going on across the way at 10 o'clock today as we prepare for the future, because we're talking about, during this pause time, we're talking about renovations to our Sunday school building. And Lord knows we need them. And how do we prepare for our future? And how do we strengthen our kids to prevent the devil from working in their lives with a facility that honors our children and our families and our future? We're going to talk about this morning at 10 o'clock. This has been a pause time for the church, but in this time of pause, we've been blessed that we are preparing for the future. How are you preparing for the months ahead? I read an article yesterday that the airports and airport security, they're preparing for this crush of travel this summer. People can't wait to travel. People can't wait to get back at it. And they're trying to prepare to prevent this chaos in the airports for what they anticipate will come when we can take our masks off and come back from the wilderness. We mark the Lent season, we mark the time before Easter in this 40 days, 46 on the calendar, but 6 Sundays, 40 weekdays other than Sunday. A Lenten season, a time to pause, a time to think about how we can better prevent the devil from working, and a time to prepare our lives for the next chapter. So many of you who I talk with during the marked times in your life, as you have an event that happens that defines and marks your life and you prepare for the next chapter, times that you all will always remember, whatever those seasons may be in your own life. Times and chapters in our church's history and in our church's life that we will mark for generations to come. Our Lord and our Savior, out in the wilderness, relied on God, His Father, relied on Scripture, prepared for His ministry ahead, and left the wilderness ready for ministry. I hope and I pray that your pause time, when you come here on Sunday, prepares you for the week ahead, prevents the devil from working in your life, and marks a time in your week when you devote yourself to the Lord. The Lenten journey that we have together is a journey of faith, of preparation, of prevention. And the time of preparation that we have in our church's history now is an exciting time. And I hope and I pray that for generations to come, we'll look back and we'll mark this time as one of those marked times. Amen. Let's stand and profess our faith.
We believe in one God,
the Father.
God, my name, upon
prayers to God. Lord God, we thank you for the leaders of our church, especially Archbishop Beach, Bishop Lawrence, Bishop Skilton, Father Marshall, Father Donnie, Father Joe, Father David, and our staff. We ask you to bless them. We also pray for St. Andrew's Mission and that and their victor, Father Jimmy Gallant. Lord God, we pray for those who proclaim the gospel at home and abroad, and for all who teach the disciple and disciple others, particular for All Saints Church in Florence, Director Father Jason Hampshaw, Chelsea, and their family, for St. Joe's Church in the Dominican Republic, their Father Sandino Sanchez, and their Bishop Moises Quesada, and for Father Rob Sturdy, Anglican chaplain at the Citadel. Lord God, we pray for the leaders of our country, especially President Biden, Governor McMaster, Mayor Tecklenburg, and we ask you to bless them. Lord God, we thank you for all our blessings, especially for people who love and care for us. Lord God, we ask you to take care of everyone who is sick or sad.
Especially Andrew Robb and Sailor Ann, Patty Bletch, Isaac Nettles, Nancy Glenn, Bob and Margaret Jones, and all others that we name aloud or silently in our hearts at this time.
Lord God, we know you hear us when we pray. We ask you that you answer our prayers as may be best for us.
Kneeling, let us humbly confess our sins to Almighty God.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to Old St. Andrews today. And
10 o'clock hour, we'll be in Gilchrist Hall across the way for a presentation. Our architect, Robert Berger, will be here, and we'll have a good opportunity to look at some plans. These are not finalized, and no decisions have been made yet, but we are moving in that direction of providing for some good renovations and upfit for our Sunday school building, which is, I believe, long overdue. So I'm excited about that. And I hope you'll come across the way and stay for that time at 10 o'clock today. I do want to give thanks to God again and encourage you to keep the Nettles family in your prayers. They will probably be in the children's hospital most of this week, just as, from what I understand, precaution, and as baby Isaac continues to strengthen. So hopefully by this time next week, they'll be at home. So just in case they're watching this morning, can we have a loud amen to that, please? Amen. Amen. So thanks be to God for Isaac's successful surgery. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself an offering and a sacrifice to God. Amen.
Thank you.
Yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty. For everything in heaven and on earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head above all. All things come from you, O Lord. The Lord be with you. Lift up your heart.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right
our duty and our joy, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. You bid your faithful people cleanse their hearts, prepare with joy for the Paschal feast, and fervent in prayer and in works of mercy, and renewed by your word and sacraments, they may come to the fullness of grace which you have prepared for those who love you. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
We shall see our Lord face to face. All this we ask you.
of your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, and give it to the Holy Spirit. All honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
Now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we roll the praise. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us eat in peace.
We do not presume to come to
this table of the merciful Lord, trusting in our righteousness, but in your abundant and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather at the crumbs on the dear table, but you are the same Lord, whose character is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so that he, the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and the drink of his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made in the name of the Father, and our souls washed in his precious blood, that we may ever grow alone in him. Amen.
This prayer for spiritual communion is for those of you watching at home and that do not have access to the consecrated elements. Dear Jesus, I believe that you are truly present in the Holy Sacrament. I love you above all things, and I desire to possess you within my soul. And since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, I beseech you to come spiritually into my heart. I unite myself to you, together with all your faithful people, and I embrace you with all the affections of my soul. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Father, we thank you for feeding us with spiritual food from this precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us of these holy mysteries that we are living in the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord. To him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, the honor and glory, now and forever. Amen.
The peace of God that passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always.
Amen. Last day.